Jesus Christ died, we died with him. Though he slays me, yet will I trust in him. Good morning. Welcome to Berean Bible Church. We're going to be talking this morning about the new temple. We've been looking at this last section of Ephesians 2 for several weeks now, and we're going to actually finish it this morning. This paragraph that we've been looking at, verses 11 through 22, can be broken down into three sections. Verses 11 through 13 describe the pre-Christian past of Paul's goyim readers in relationship to Israel, and then their present position in Christ. Let's look at that. He says, "Therefore remember that formerly you, the Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision." Now, and we've talked a lot about this in the last couple of weeks, Gentiles here, I think, includes the northern kingdom of Israel, the 10 northern tribes. They were goyim, but it's not exclusive to them. This is true of all goyim, and I say that because the northern kingdom became goyim. They were not his people. So he's talking to them. They are uncircumcised. He says, by the so-called circumcision. I like that so-called because they had the badge of circumcision, but it was performed, he says, by flesh, by human hands. In other words, it wasn't of the heart. So even the Jews who lived in Judea, they weren't right with God either. He says, remember that you were at that time separate from Christ. That goes for both groups, Gentiles and Jews. They were separated from Christ, excluded from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. Both those groups, they were without God. And this is a transition you got to love. But now, that denotes the contrast between their present condition and their past. Thank God for the but now. And I want to ask you, do you have a but now? Well, this second division is verses 14 through 18, and they explain how this coming near was made possible through Christ. He says, but now in Christ Yeshua, you who were formerly far away, far off, and the far off referred to those who weren't in Jerusalem, they weren't near the temple. Everything's in relation to the temple. You're far off because you're not near the temple. You've been brought near the temple by the blood of Christ. So you understand, it's not a physical temple he's talking about here. He explains how this union is possible in Christ Jesus, that Christ has made the Jews and the goyim into one new man. He says, for he himself is our peace, who made both groups, the Israelites, the non-Israelites, into one, broke down the barrier of the dividing wall by abolishing in his flesh the enmity, which is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so that in himself he might make the two into one new man. People, it's not, you know, okay, God, to me this is an argument against those who say, well, the Gentiles here are just the 10 northern tribes and God's just reuniting the tribes. It's one new man. It's not putting back together what was before. It is a new man, thus establishing peace. Now, it was the Torah that separated the nations from Israel. And in Christ's finished work, we see that this wall that Paul explains as this enmity, the law of commandments, has been destroyed. It has been abolished. So much of the church doesn't understand this. They're still putting people under law. I was having a conversation yesterday with Bob Dorian. We were talking about tithing. And he says, it just makes it easy for people. And I said, that's why preachers use it. They got, here's the number, 10%, give it. But if you're going to be accurate, tithing is really 23 1/3%. So let's not cheat God, okay, with a chintzy 10%. All right, if you're giving your waitress 20, you need to give God 23, right? Do this. The law has been destroyed. We're not under tithing in the new covenant. We're under giving. How much should you give? How's God blessed you? You know, this abolishing of Torah, this is not an isolated incident. Throughout the scriptures, it talks about this, the New Testament. We see a picture of this abolishing of Torah, I think, in the Transfiguration. Now, in the Transfiguration, I'm going to just read these verses here, and we'll fill in the context here. Mark 9, 7 and 8 says, "Then a cloud formed, overshadowing them, and a voice came out of the cloud. This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." All at once, they looked around and saw no one with them anymore except Yeshua alone. Well, who was with them? Moses and Elijah were there, right on this mount of transfiguration. All right, the cloud here is used in the Tanakh as a symbol of God's presence. And it's best to take the mention of the cloud here on the mountain as a supernatural phenomenon. He's not saying, well, it's kind of a cloudy day and this cloud just kind of drifted over the mountain. That's not what he's talking about. It was the cloud of the Shekinah. You know what the Shekinah is? You've heard it said Shekinah. Okay, the Hebrew is Shekinah. All right? It's the glory of God appeared on that mountaintop. Shekinah comes from Hebrew, which means to dwell. The Shekinah glory of God was the manifestation of His presence. So, if you remember when the tabernacle was finished, this cloud descended upon it, and it was such a manifestation of the glory of God that Moses couldn't even enter the tabernacle because this beautiful presence of God just filled it. And when Solomon's temple was complete, the cloud again descended so that the priest couldn't enter it. The cloud symbolized the dwelling of Yahweh among men. And this Shekinah glory of God had not been seen in Israel for 600 years. But now, this luminous cloud not only came, but it enveloped all of them. The entire top of the mountain was covered by the glory of God. And the voice says this, "Listen to him," referring to Yeshua. It's a strong term. It means take notice, obey. Listen to him, who? Yeshua, as opposed to who? Moses and Elijah, who were there. See, Yeshua is greater than Moses. He's greater than Elijah. In him came the full truth about Yahweh. All other messengers had been superseded. Now, what was the point of Moses and Elijah being there with Christ in the first place? Well, it wouldn't have been any less spectacular if they wouldn't have been there, right? The purpose was they represented the law and the prophets, the old covenant. And Yeshua is the minister of the new covenant, according to Hebrews 12, 24, and to Yeshua, the mediator of a new covenant. Hebrews 9, 15 says, "And for this reason, he is the mediator of a new covenant." See, on this mountain, God is saying in picture form, the old covenant is being superseded by the new. Everyone today wants to seem to mix the two. They don't mix, all right? Yeshua has been saying and doing things all along in his ministry to try to get them in this understanding that the Torah was going to be superseded. Look at Mark 7, 18. "And he said to them, are you so lacking in understanding also? Do you not understand that whatever goes into the man from outside cannot defile him?" Now, you might read that and not even catch it, but he's talking to Jews here. Did what they ate defile them? Yeah, this is a very radical statement. To the Pharisees and to any Jew, this statement went against their dietary laws. Food was a major consideration in the Old Covenant. It's clear from even a supernatural reading of Leviticus 11, what they could and could not eat. Now, what do we do when there's a conflict between what Yeshua teaches and what the law taught? Well, God the Father said, listen to Yeshua. The old covenant was to fade away in significance during the lifetime of the disciples. Hebrews 8:13. This is a verse you need to know, you need to have marked, you need to memorize. When he said a new covenant, he has made the first obsolete. But whatever is becoming obsolete, it's in the process, and growing old is ready to disappear. It did disappear at AD 70. So Moses and Elijah were there so Yahweh could say, it is now time to listen to my son. Mark 9, 8 says, "And all at once they looked around and saw no one with them anymore except Yeshua alone." Moses and Elijah are gone. Yahweh had spoken. He had singled out his son. And now all that filled their vision was Christ. What Yahweh was saying was his son, Christ, was the supreme significance. All other things were to point to him. So the law was abolished by Christ. It no longer separates Jews from Goyim. And you understand how it separated them. They have been made into one new man. These laws had to go away because these laws made Israel distinct. They're not distinct anymore. All right, let's go on in Ephesians 2:16 says, and might reconcile them both into one body. There's only one body. To God through the cross. By it having put to death the enmity, and he came and preached peace to you who were far away, those out of Jerusalem, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have one access in one spirit to the Father. Once there were Jews and Goyim. Now Christ comes and unites them to himself so that in him there would be only one new person, namely Christ. There's neither Jew nor Goyim, but Christ is all and in all. Colossians 3:11 says a renewal in which there is no distinction between Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, and free man, but Christ is all and in all. Christ is the new man. Jew and Goyim make up the one body of this new man. The death of Christ created a new humanity, if you will, a third category, a third race, as it's been called. When you come to faith in Christ, you become a member of the church. And listen, effectively and spiritually, you lose your nationality. You lose your political allegiance, and you become one in Christ. Believers are a new creation, a new race that's different, something that the world had never seen before. Now, in the third and final section, verses 19 through 22, they take and apply the truths of verses 14 through 18 to the reader's new privileged position in Christ. And Paul closes his discussion on the unity of the body by giving three metaphors to illustrate how Jew and Goyim have been made one. How there's no more division, no more separation. He calls us first fellow citizens. Then he calls us a household of God. Then he calls us a holy temple. So we have the figure of a kingdom. We're fellow citizens with the saints. We have the figure of a family. We're members of a household. And then we have the figure of a building, a holy temple, for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. Verse 19 says, so then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and are of God's household. So then, this introduces the consequence of the preceding verses, that the Goyim and the Jews have been made reconciled into one and to Yahweh through the cross. He says, you are no longer strangers and aliens. Now, in verse 12, Paul said that they were strangers to the covenants of promise. The word strangers refers to a foreigner, while the word alien refers to a foreigner who lives in the land as a resident alien. Both words convey that they were outside of Israel, and that's the whole point here. You were strangers, you were aliens, you were outside of Israel. Now, is this speaking of the redeemed of the northern kingdom? Or is this speaking of non-Israelites, Goyim? Yes. Okay? Because they're one in the same. Once God divorced Israel, Israel became Goyim. They were not his people. So it doesn't matter what category you want to put on this. They both fit into it. But they're no longer strangers. They're outside of whoever this is. They're outside of Israel. They're strangers and aliens. Now, even though you may be living in the country legally, you don't possess the same rights as legal citizens if you're a stranger or an alien. The word alien here is from the Greek word paroikos, which is used in the Septuagint 26 times, mostly translated from ger. Remember ger from last week? Saw last week that the ger were to be treated as natives by the Israelites. They were to love the ger, the non-Israelites, as themselves. And we saw that the ger could draw near. They could worship Yahweh as long as they came through Israel. All right? They were strangers. They were aliens, but they could worship Yahweh as they came through Israel. Now, look at Deuteronomy 14:21. It says, you are not to eat any animal that dies naturally. He's talking to the Israelites, but watch. Although you may let the stranger staying with you eat it. See, there were, even though these Ger could come and worship Yahweh, they could get circumcised, they could come in, they could worship, there was always this distinction. They were always not quite, you know, they were the stepchild, so to speak. All right, they were not quite part of the family. Because here he tells Israel, if it dies natural, you can't touch it, but you can give it to the stranger. They can eat it. Look at Deuteronomy 15:3. You may demand that a foreigner repay his debt, but you are to release your claim on whatever your brother owes you. So we see there's a distinction between these groups, even though they have attached themselves to Israel. Look at Deuteronomy 23:20. You may charge interest to a foreigner, but to your countrymen, you shall not charge interest. So even though the Ger could worship Yahweh, there was a difference between them and Israel. But Paul says to the Goyim, you are no longer strangers and aliens, because the new covenant, there is no distinction. None. None whatsoever. Now, some people consider any view that does not exalt the Jews as being anti-Semitic. Well, let me tell you, people, under the new covenant, the Jews have no exalted place, no place any different than you and me. The nation is no different than you and me. None of them is any. There is no difference now. They're just lost if they're outside of Christ. That's all that matters. So all these ministries that are putting such a big emphasis on this, they're way off the mark. Okay? And they're supporting a bunch of Christ-rejecting God-haters is what they're doing in the name of Christianity. All right, I got to get going. I'll get stuck on that and stick my foot in my mouth. So they're not any longer strangers and aliens. She says, but you're fellow citizens. Now, okay, in the old covenant, they could attach to Israel, but they were still strangers. They still had that distance. But now, guess what? You're fellow citizens. The adversative conjunction Allah here, but, marks a strong contrast from the negative that was just stated. You're fellow citizens. This is from the Greek word sumpolites. This Greek word is not found in the Septuagint. It occurs only here in the New Testament. What it is, it's the opposite of a foreigner. The goy are now kingdom citizens. Previously in the Old Covenant, they were strangers, they were aliens. They were not at home within the kingdom of God, but now they are citizens. Now, to the Greek-Roman culture to which Paul was writing in Ephesus, citizenship was the highest personal thing you could have. I mean, we're very, very individualistic in this country. Way too much. We don't understand this. But being linked to a polis, to a city-state, to them was everything. That was their identity. I'm a citizen of this country or this city. That meant a lot to them. It spoke of your identity in every way. To become naturalized is to take a foreigner and admit him to the country, to give him citizenship. This just happened to Impano. A few weeks ago, she became a naturalized citizen. She became a citizen of the United States of America. But it took a lot of money and a lot of effort to get it done. Okay? It did. What Paul is telling the goy in our text is they have become, I'm going to coin a word here, supernaturalized. Okay? You become citizens of the kingdom of God. And listen, through no effort of your own, through no cost of your own, but through faith in Yeshua. Paul is using the analogy of the church. Both Jews and Goy are God's nation. They are God's kingdom. They are brought together in Christ. You know, from Abraham until the time of Christ, the Jews are God's chosen nation. He revealed himself to them in a way that he did not do with other people on the earth. He made exclusive covenants, exclusive promises with them. But now, Yahweh has created a new man, the church, the body of Christ, made up of Jews and Goyim. The church is presently his kingdom. It's his people. No longer are the Goy second-class citizens. They're fellow citizens with the saints. And like I said, Israel has no distinction, no priority in the kingdom whatsoever. We're given the rights and privileges now of full citizenship because we are one. Because Christ is the fulfillment of the covenant. And if we are in Him, By faith, we partake of all the blessings that he received. You see, Yeshua is the true Israel. None of the nation Israel ever fulfilled the covenant. None of them, except one, Yeshua. And all the promises to the seed of Abraham and to the seed of David were not fulfilled in Isaac or Jacob or Solomon. These covenants all pointed toward the one who would fulfill every covenant, and that is Yeshua. And we are in him by faith. He says, your fellow citizens with the saints. This is the Hebrew word, kodesh. It means holy or set apart. And we see from the Tanakh that it's Israel that was set apart. They were a kingdom of priests. They were a holy nation. They were a holy nation and a holy people to Yahweh. But now, here's Paul, an Israelite himself. He's using the same designation for the goy, who by faith in Yeshua are joined to the great saints of the Tanakh. We are joined with men like Abraham, Moses, Elijah, Elisha, David, Isaiah, Jeremiah. We have an inheritance with them. We belong to the same kingdom, the same body. Your spiritual new birth in Christ has made you a supernaturalized citizen of the kingdom. Then Paul says we are of God's household. The Greek here is oikeos. It's found in the Septuagint 19 times. It's mostly translated from the word blood relation. This is an advance on the metaphor we just saw of the citizen. Okay, you were a citizen. Guess what? Now you're a family. We're all citizens of the kingdom in Christ, but more than that, the apostle says, we are members of Yahweh's own intimate family. The sense of belonging is much stronger in a family than in a national sense. I guess you understand that, right? John could never get over this. He said, see how great a love the Father has bestowed on us that we should be called the children of God. What an incredible privilege. In the Tanakh, to come under the household of someone meant much more than it does to us today. So if you were in a household, whether you were genetically related or not, you were family. And you had all the rights afforded to a family member because you were part of that household. There are millions of citizens of our nation. But to be a member of the household is personal and more intimate. Family members know one another. In Paul's day, to be a member of a household meant refuge. It meant protection. It meant identity. I'm part of this family. In the first letter to Timothy, Paul says that the household of God is the church. But in case I'm delayed, I write so that you will know how you ought to conduct yourself in the household of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and support of the truth. This is a little off our topic here, but I just want you to notice that that's the church's calling, to be a pillar, to be a support of the truth, nothing else. It's not called to put on programs, to do all these, it's to be a pillar, to support, hold up the truth of God. So we are citizens of the kingdom of God, which is the church. And we are adopted into the household of God, which is the church. And now Paul gives a third analogy of a building. You say, well, it seems like that's going backwards, a building. That's kind of impersonal, is it? You know, most buildings are constructed, but this one's a little different. This building is growing. Okay? You ever seen a building grow? Having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Yeshua himself being the cornerstone. See, this is not just any building, but rather the temple where Yahweh manifests his presence in a special way. Now, Yahweh is omnipresent, we know that. But there's a special sense in which he dwells within his temple. The Jews experienced this as the Shekinah, the brilliant manifestation of the glory of God. But now Paul says the church is this temple. For New Testament believers, there's no such thing as a sacred building. I know I'm a little nitpicky, but when someone calls the auditorium of a church the sanctuary, I'm like, you don't understand what a sanctuary is, okay? The sanctuary is the dwelling of God. God's not hanging out in the auditorium. All right, that's a reference to the church, his people. God's temple now consists of people. It's not a sacred building somewhere. People say, you need to behave in church. What does that mean? That's right. Now, at first glance, you may think what Paul is saying about the church here, that it's been built on the foundation of the prophets of the Old Covenant and the apostles of the New Covenant. But notice the order. It's not prophets and apostles, it's apostles and prophets. And I think he's talking here about New Testament prophets. We read about them in the Scriptures. They're men like Agabus and Silas. Look at what Paul said to the Corinthians. For no man can lay a foundation other than the one which is laid, which is Yeshua the Christ. So here Paul says that Yeshua is the foundation, but in Ephesians 2 he says the apostles and prophets are the foundation. Now, what sense then can the apostles and prophets be the foundation and Christ also be the foundation? Well, I think that what he means here is that Christ is the foundation, but it's by means of the teaching of the apostles and the prophets that we are given revelation and teaching concerning the Lord Yeshua as the head of this church. And so it's upon the apostolic teaching concerning Christ that it is built. He says they were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching. They're teaching about Christ and to fellowship and the breaking of bread and prayer. Look what John says about the apostles in Revelation 21:14. He said, and the wall of the city had 12 foundation stones, and on them were the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. They're the foundation because they're teaching about Christ. See, before the canon of the New Testament was completed, the prophets received direct revelation from God to build up and encourage the church. And they had miraculous sign gifts to verify that what they were saying came from God. Paul's point here is the church was founded on the truth that we now possess in the New Testament, the testimony about Yeshua. Now, since the apostles are the foundation and not the roof, I think the implication is there's no apostles today. But I see things all the time that so-and-so is the apostle of this church. And I'm like, really? I wonder if they know what an apostle is. The office of prophet and apostle are things of the past. No Christian since the first century had any such office. No one today receives new revelations from God. The canon is closed. And people think of the implications. If the canon is not closed, if so-and-so, you know, it's usually apostle so-and-so, Mrs. What's-her-name, she's the apostle, she's getting new revelation from God. New meaning outside of Scripture. Okay, now your Bible just became incomplete. Because it doesn't contain everything. Now you got to go down the street and find out, what does she say so I can add it to this? Because it's on the same revelation as, you know, same par as this. No, it's not. This is closed. This is done. You're not getting new revelation. Our job is to try to understand the revelation we already have, okay? We're not getting anything new, people. You don't have to run around all over town finding out what everybody's saying, what God has told them. Please notice that this new temple is not built on the foundation of the Mosaic Law. It's built on the teaching of the apostles about Yeshua, the Christ. We've got to understand that. He says, Christ Yeshua himself being the cornerstone. Now, the cornerstone was the major stone that was set down. I don't think we understand this in our culture because, you know, it's not really used anymore. But it had, in that culture, it was everything. It had to be large enough to support the superstructure. It had to be accurate enough because the walls were conformed to the angle of that stone, and every other block in the entire building had to fit with that stone. So you don't begin building a wall from the center out and up. You set a cornerstone, and from it, the trajectory of all the walls are already set. The builder would place that cornerstone so the rest of the building would grow out from that stone. So the cornerstone was the thing that framed everything. It was the thing to which everything was adapted. The cornerstone was the support. It was the unifier. It was the connector. It was the strength giver. It was everything. And that's what Christ is to the church. Peter, when addressing the Sanhedrin, speaks about this cornerstone. And if we look in the book of Acts, we see this story, the setting of the story centers on the healing of a lame beggar in the temple. The story's physical healing is simply an illustration to demonstrate the greater reality of the spiritual healing. Acts 4:10 says, let it be known to all of you, Peter speaking to the Sanhedrin, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Yeshua the Christ, the Nazarene, I want you to make sure you understand who this guy is, okay? Whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. In other words, you are in opposition to God. By this name, this man stands here before you in good health. They're wanting an explanation. Why is this guy healed? Peter says to the Sanhedrin, you killed him. God raised him. You're at odds with God. You claim to worship God. You claim to be all about God. You're at odds with God. So in the presence of the Sanhedrin, Peter boldly indicts Israel for the execution of Christ. Then to support his case, he indirectly cites Scripture. He says, he is the stone which was rejected by you, the builders, but which became the very cornerstone. He is citing here from Psalm 118:22, which says, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Did you see what Peter added to the phrase? Now remember, Peter is speaking under inspiration. This is what Psalm says, and Peter adds this, rejected by you, the builders. Oh, he makes it real personal. This is, you're fulfilling the prophecy that God gave to Israel. The builders, you're the builders. And you rejected the stone. You set it at naught because it didn't seem to fit with what you wanted. But God made him the cornerstone of the new temple. And with this metaphor, the biblical writers established that the kingdom of God would be founded on Yeshua the Christ. Now, if this new temple is built on Yeshua and the apostles, it should be clear that it's not a physical building, okay? This is a spiritual temple. This is the church. This is the body of Christ. Look at verse 21. In whom the whole building being fitted together is growing into a holy temple in the Lord. The word building here is from the Greek word oikeidome. It's used in classical writers of a building or the act of building. Now, in the present context, it has to refer to the act of building because the following participle and the main verb denote that the building is still in the process of construction. The building that is being built is the New Jerusalem. We'll talk about this in a second. The verb here, fitted together, is a very rare verb in the Greek language. It means every single part fits snugly, perfectly together. Believers are the temple of God. Look at 2 Corinthians 6:16. Or what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For we are the temple of the living God. Now notice what Peter says when writing about this temple. He says, and coming to him as to a living stone, referring to Yeshua. He's a cornerstone, but he's a living cornerstone, which has been rejected by men, but is choice and precious in the sight of God. Now watch. You also, as living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Yeshua the Christ. You see the difference here? You're spiritual stones. That temple was built of these stones, and now it's a living temple, and the sacrifices are spiritual. We're not carrying animals there anymore. We're offering up the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving and glory to God. Notice the corporateness that comes with being a living stone. He says, we're being built together into a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. The church is the temple. The temple was where worship was carried on. It was where Yahweh dwelt, and the church is that temple. He says it's growing into a holy temple. Now the present tense verb, along with the preceding participle, shows the continuance of the growth process, indicating this is a living organism. It continues to increase. It's not the future tense looking forward to some eschatological temple. It's the present tense dealing with the present temple that is not finished but continues to grow. Now the Greek word for temple here is naos, which is the Holy of Holies. It is not the word hieros, which would refer to the temple and its porticos, its outbuildings. In Matthew 24:1, Yeshua came, it says, Yeshua came out from the hieros, out from the temple. This word here, naos, though, is talking about the Holy of Holies. Very distinct, very different, because that's the place where God dwelt. He says, in whom ye also What was said of the whole body of believers is here affirmed of to the Ephesian Christians. You also are being built together into a dwelling of God in the Spirit. See, the ongoing process results in a building where God dwells. The verb is present indicative with the tense again indicating the continuance of the building. Process is that this building is growing, is being built. Goyim, together with the Jews, are becoming a dwelling place of God. Yahweh has created something entirely new and unexpected in the birth of the church. Jews are no longer distinguished from Goyim. Goyim need not become Jews to be saved and enter into the blessings which Yahweh has promised to Abraham. The church is a new entity born by the death, burial, resurrection of Christ. Everyone who believes in Christ is part of this body, without distinction. Now, we saw in verse 21 that the building is still in the process of construction. It is growing into a holy temple. The present tense verb shows the continuance of growth, indicating a living organism that continues to increase. Verse 22 talks about the ongoing process of the building being built. The growing process can only be understood by someone who understands fulfilled eschatology. This passage can only be understood by someone who knows what time it is. And as I said, most people don't know what time it is. All right, the green here is the Old Covenant. The blue is the New Covenant. The first red line is Pentecost. All right, at Pentecost, you see the New Covenant began. That's where it started, but not just a little bit of it there, a lot of Old Covenant. But as you go along, you notice the Old Covenant ends there. Where does it end? It ends at the destruction of the temple. And then on the other side of AD 70, out of the transition period, we have Yahweh's temple. And by the way, this is where you are. You're here. You're not in the middle of the... Most people see ourselves in between those two lines in the transition period. And they're still looking forward to things that have already happened. Most people see you as here. You're in that transition period. And that's why it's so important that we understand what time it is. We understand that past AD 70, we have moved into the temple. Let's look at it this way. You got AD 70 there. You can see the green of the Old Covenant. It ends at AD 70. It terminates there, okay, at the second coming. And then you have the New Covenant, and it just continues to expand and grow. This New Covenant is the temple of Yahweh. It's so important that we understand what time. And just to show you, let me give you a couple quotes from some of the commentators on these verses in Ephesians. They say this. This metaphor, speaking of the temple, the building, depicts believers as a carefully joined, constantly growing temple inhabited by God. The Jews and Gentiles are now an ever-growing spiritual structure indwelt by God. Well, see, the problem is this is not an ever-growing temple. It was finished at AD 70, and Yahweh moved into it. Okay? Another commentator writes this, "The apostle and prophets laid the foundation for the church, and now it is continuing to be built up, completed just before our Lord established his kingdom on earth." Again, he sees it as continuing to grow because he doesn't know what time it is. John MacArthur writes this, and it grows. The temple grows. Why? Because new stones are added all the time, right? No, wrong. New stones are added. I agree with him on that. People are still being added to this temple, but the temple is complete. See, the building itself is finished, and the nations are flowing into this temple that has been finished. But in AD 70, it was finished, and God came and indwelt his finished temple. Just like when Solomon built the temple, God wasn't there until it was finished. They dedicated it. The Shekinah glory descended upon it. God resided in that temple until Ezekiel 11, and then he started moving out of it. Okay? This is the new temple. This new temple was promised throughout the Tanakh. Israel looked for this temple. Look at Isaiah chapter 2. Now, it will come about in the last days. Okay, you know when that is, right? Not now. We're not in the last days. The mountain of the house of Yahweh will be established as the chief of the mountains and will be raised above the hills, and all the nations will stream to it. All the goyim are going to stream. The goy are going to go here to this mountain, and many peoples will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of Yahweh, to the house of the God of Jacob." That's the temple, his house. that he may teach us concerning his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For the law will go forth from Zion, and the word of Yahweh from Jerusalem. Now, dispensationalism puts a great emphasis on a rebuilt physical temple and a priesthood, because they fail to see these as types. Physical Israel was a type, and so was the tabernacle a type. Look at Hebrews 8:5. Who serve, he's talking about the tabernacle, he says, they serve as a copy and a shadow of the heavenly things. Just as Moses was warned by God when he was about to erect the tabernacle, for see, he says, that you make all things according to the pattern which was shown you on the mountain. So the tabernacle is a type. What's the antitype? It's Yeshua. Look what he says in John 2:19. Yeshua answered and said to him, destroy this temple. 3 days, I'll raise it up. Why? Because I'm the antitype of the temple. I'm the living temple of God. He replaces the temple. The temple represented the presence of Yahweh among his people. Look at Acts 2, 2 and 3. Pentecost, and suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting, and there appeared to them tongues of fire distributing themselves, and they rested on each one of them. Notice here these tongues of fire. What's the significance of this? Well, throughout the scripture, fire is always a sign of Yahweh's presence among his people. So note how at Pentecost, the manifestation of the flaming presence of Yahweh is not positioned over the tent. It's over the people. Why? Because they are the new tabernacle, the new dwelling place of God. Yahweh is descending in fire on this new tabernacle of his people. This is the promise of the new covenant where Yahweh will dwell with them. Now, I said earlier that the building is the new Jerusalem. Look at what John writes. He says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no longer any sea. And I saw the holy city, new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride adorned for her husband. Now, most people read this and they say, this is the future. We're looking for a new heaven. We're looking for a new earth. Well, what we really have here is the building is now finished. And God comes down and he indwells it. Now notice that the new heaven and the new earth is the new Jerusalem according to Scripture. All right, they're the same. He said, I saw a new heaven. I saw a new earth. And he said, and I saw the holy city, new Jerusalem. It's the same thing. And here's what I want you to understand. To me, this is such a significant Scripture in understanding preterism and teaching someone about preterism. The new Jerusalem that you see coming down here is the new covenant. People are looking for this new Jerusalem somewhere off in the future. It's going to come, this literal physical building is going to come down. It would disrupt the earth's position. Okay, this building is so big. All right, but look at, the Bible teaches us that the new Jerusalem is the new covenant. Look at Galatians 4. You got to mark this passage. This is what you share with people. This is allegorically speaking, for these women are two covenants. All right? He's explaining. These women represent two different covenants. One proceeding from Mount Sinai, we know what that is, bearing children who are to be slaves. You get that? Under that old covenant, they're slaves. She's Hagar. Now, this Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia and corresponds to the present Jerusalem. Not our present Jerusalem. The Jerusalem at the time of the writing. Okay? It was the old covenant. She is in slavery with her children. Now, watch verse 26. But the new Jerusalem is free. She's our mother. So you got two covenants represented by two Jerusalems, our earthly one and the heavenly one. And in Revelation, we see the heavenly one coming down, which is just a symbol for the new covenant. So the new Jerusalem is the new heavens and the new earth, which is the new covenant. Now, notice the dimensions of this new Jerusalem. Revelation 21:16. The city is laid out as a square, and its length is as great as its width. And he measured the city with a rod, 1,500 miles. Its length and width and height are equal. That is a big city, people. What's the significance of that? Its height and width, its length and width and height are equal. What's that mean? It's a cube, right? Do you know that the Holy of Holies in the tabernacle was a cube? Perfect cube? So what's he saying here? He's saying this, New Jerusalem, is the Holy of Holies. It's the dwelling place of God. All right? It's a perfect cube, just as the Holy of Holies was. Yahweh's dwelling place is the New Jerusalem. Look at 21:3. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men." The New Jerusalem has come, and it's among men. And He shall dwell among them, and they shall be His people, and God Himself shall be among them. You know what's really sad is so many people look forward to this. I can't wait for God to dwell among us. He's doing it now. How sad that you miss out on what you have because you're looking for something that you already have. In the New Covenant, which is the New Jerusalem, which is the New Temple, is where Yahweh dwells with His people. There's no more Jews, no more Goyim. There's only one new man, the body of Christ. Believers, we live in the New Covenant. Thus, we are in the temple of the New Jerusalem, dwelling with Yahweh now. Believers, the church is God's temple, which was completed in AD 70. Our God is not up there, out there, somewhere. He is with us. He dwells in us. We are His people. It's hard for us to understand because we don't fully grasp that old covenant. You know, when the Lord came down on Mount Sinai, what did He tell the people? Stay back. Don't touch the mountain. You touch it, your animals touch it, you die. You don't want to be in the presence of Yahweh. Okay? Thunder and lightning and shaking. That old covenant was fearful. When it was inaugurated, 3,000 people died. New covenant was inaugurated, 3,000 people came to life. And now, listen, the veil has been torn to demonstrate there was nothing in there. God came back in the presence of Yeshua, the Shekinah glory of God, and He dwells with us now. And all we have to do is avail ourselves to that. You know, it's sad that He is here. He is with us. We have access to the throne of God 24/7, and we fail to use it. It's like almost a life preserver on a ship. You hope it's there, but you hope you don't ever need it. You know, that's not what it should be like. We dwell in His presence. How beautiful to fellowship with Him day or night, anytime we want to live in that fellowship. We don't have to go to a priest. We don't have to grab an animal and take it out and sacrifice. It's all done in Christ. Believers, we are the living temple of God. Let's pray. Father, we thank You this morning for New Covenant truth. Lord, we thank You for these metaphors that You have taught us, that we are citizens of the kingdom, that we are family members of Your household, and Lord, that we are the temple, the literal dwelling place of Yahweh. Thank You, Lord, for that privilege. I pray that You would help us to realize what we have in You and to live it out daily in our lives. Thank You, Lord, for Your incredible grace to us. Amen.